Henry Hank Stram out of Gary, Indiana. He's a Purdue graduate. He went to Purdue, coached at Purdue, helped recruit me there, and the guy that was very, very instrumental in giving me an opportunity to really perform professionally when he signed me with the Dallas Texans in 1962. So I owe a great deal to this man, to the success that I have had.
Would you have, do you think you would have had the opportunities you had were it not for Hank?
I would not have.
You know that for sure.
I don't know it for sure, but I feel very strongly that I would not have had the opportunity, because I wasn't very good when I went to the Dallas Texans, because I hadn't played in 5 years and my skills had eroded because I hadn't been used. And so, but he knew how to bring that back, and it took a while, and he stayed with me a while, but eventually came back.
How did he do that? What did he do that that you think?
He worked on the he was the finest quarterback coach that I'd ever had. Some of these other coaches didn't know anything about the quarterback position, the techniques of the quarterback position. He knew the fundamentals of it. He broke it down to everything that I had to do, from my footwork, how I took the snap, how I turned, and he worked on these drills every day in practice. In practice every day with this, say with Pittsburgh and Cleveland, those guys didn't know anything about the quarterback position. They knew about theory, the passing theory and things like that, but the quarterback position, this guy knew about.
Beyond that, he believed in you.
Yeah, he did. I think he did. Maybe not the first couple of weeks, but he stayed with me long enough. You know, Lamar was ready to cut me. Yeah, he and I found out Lamar, and his, because they used to cut the team, you know, not really, but say when they look at people, oh, he'll make it, he's got a chance. No, that guy doesn't have it. Not only I found out that Lamar, but his brothers too. So I thought the whole Hunt family was against me. Thank gosh, goodness I had this guy on my side.
He was just a character in addition to that. But he kind of works his way in and out of your life from about 18 to all the way.
Absolutely, yes. And got to know him very well. I introduced him when he was inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame. He introduced me when I went into the Pro Football Hall of Fame. So there was a very close relationship with Hank and his family, because I've known his family, the boys and girls in his family, since they were born. So goes back all the way to Purdue.
Too much to say second father, maybe, figure?
Yeah, he would never accept that, because he'd say he's not old enough to be my father.
Tell me a little bit more about Hank, because the video that I've seen of him along the sidelines, I imagine he was a very, I mean, just what I've seen, animated, agitated, but he was hilarious. The things that come out of his mouth. Was he a guy who kept the team loose?
Hank had a great sense of humor. His type of sense of humor. Now, I didn't think it was so funny because I didn't know he was wired. Nobody knew he was wired for the Super Bowl. And generally speaking, when I was calling most of the plays, he'd send some in. This, I'm just talking on a regular basis. The quarterbacks in those days called the plays. And generally when I'd come to the sideline at a timeout, he might ask me if I was working on anything. Because we were a play-action type of football team, we'd run plays to set up something else where we could come up with a big play. So instead of asking me what I was planning on, I come to the sidelines, he kept telling me what to do. Lenny, you got to do more of this, do more of that. It's up to you. And these people are like a Chinese fire drill out there. And it's giving all this stuff. And I said, boy, is he nervous. I'm the guy they're trying to barbecue down here in New Orleans. What's he got to be so nervous about? And didn't know that he was wired until the next spring when they had the premiere. I think it was at the Lyric Theater. Of the 30-minute highlight film, and then I figured out why, you know, he was so animated on the sidelines. Now, there's another part to that story. We opened the season the next year. This is when that was the last game played between the AFL and NFL before the merger, and you got the AFC, NFC. Now there was interdivision play, AFC, NFC. We opened the season the next year against the Minnesota Vikings in Minnesota. Now, Bud Grant was also the coach of the Minnesota Vikings. He was also asked if he wanted to partake in being wired for Super Bowl IV, and he promptly told him where to put that microphone. And no was the answer.
Very Bud Grant-like.
Yes, but here we go. We're opening up against him in the Minnesota Vikings. Now, Bud Grant did not like to have his players get to the stadium too early. What he wanted to do, get there just in time to get dressed and get ready to go out for pregame warm-up. So consequently, they would tape their ankles and do all that stuff at the hotel where they were staying. As a matter of fact, once he miscalculated the traffic and they were 15 minutes late for the kickoff for a game. And, you know, they kicked another 15 minutes late is all. He wasn't going to cancel it. But anyway, on this particular day, he said, there's something you might be interested in seeing, this little video that I have, or film. He showed, you know, you thought it was humorous. I thought it was humorous. Minnesota Vikings did not think it was humorous. So they watched that film of Super Bowl IV with Hank being wired before they got to the stadium. And when they came to the field, I don't know as if their feet hit the ground. They were so fired up and wired. And so we paid for that.
Did you? Oh, what was the final score?
I don't know what it was, but they whipped us pretty good.